almost 3 miles below this formation of American flying fortresses, there lies Marienburg in East Prussia. Up to this moment, one of the most important cogs in Germany's war machine. The specific target on which this lead bombardier is lining up his bombsight is the Focke Wulf 190 plant. Up to this instant, this aircraft factory has been accounting for almost 50% of Germany's total FW-190 fighter assembly.
Bombs away.
Tons of bombs rain down in a tight pattern of destruction. This, remember, is no area attack. It is an assault on one single target, and any bomb that falls outside that target has failed to achieve its purpose. The assembly of fighters in this Focke Wulf factory has come to a sudden and violent end. To many, the bombing of Germany probably seems to be little more than a series of capricious adventures, one attack unconnected in any way with the one that preceded it or the one that will follow it. It is easy for the average citizen to envision the positions of ground armies because of maps like these, which make the positions of the contesting forces quite clear. It is harder to express so graphically the progress of a bombing program. Yet there is a real line in this battle of Germany, not a geographical front, but an industrial one. In the British Isles, there are the Allied air forces. On the European continent, we have Regensburg, Marienburg, Bremen, Oschersleben, Warnemünde, and Kassel. These are the major German fighter assembly plants, and as such, are actually the center of Germany's industrial defense line. However, these are only the places where the aircraft is assembled into the finished fighting machine. Component parts for German fighters are made at Anklam. Here's a real line in this battle of Germany, not a geographical front, but an industrial one. In the British Isles, there are the Allied air forces. On the European continent, we have Regensburg, Marienburg, Bremen, Oschersleben, Warnemünde, and Kassel. These are the major German fighter assembly plants, and as such, are actually the center of Germany's industrial defense line. However, these are only the places where the aircraft is assembled into the finished fighting machine. Component parts for German fighters are made at Anklam, the Weserflugzeugbau works at Bremen, the great Hedderheim propeller works near Frankfurt, the aircraft tire factory at Hanover, the CAM ball bearing plant at Paris, and the ball bearing factories at Schweinfurt. Obviously, an assembly plant can't operate if other plants aren't building the parts from which the enemy planes will be assembled. Hulse produced 29% of all German synthetic rubber production and is in fact responsible for 18% of her entire supply of rubber, natural or synthetic. At Bochum, there's a great steel plant producing high-grade aviation steel. Herøya, up in Norway, is a great producer of aluminum and magnesium, metals which figure importantly in aircraft production. At Hamm, there are great railroad marshaling yards, having a capacity of 10,000 freight cars a day. Much of the tonnage handled here is closely connected with the manufacture, assembly, maintenance, and repair of enemy aircraft. And so it is all over Germany and occupied Europe. Everywhere there are plants and installations that contribute directly or indirectly to the making of German aircraft. Industrial bastions which must first be ripped apart before the enemy's armies can be destroyed. The smashing blows by the Allied air forces at Hulse, Herøya, Regensburg, Schweinfurt, Hanover, and Frankfurt have had the result of piercing the German industrial line to the extent of 37.5% of estimated single-engine fighter production in September of 1943. If this rate of drop continues, there can be only one result: the eventual disappearance of the Luftwaffe as a defensive force. But these attacks have had other far-reaching effects. For instance, in January of 1943, just when the 8th Bomber Command had started daylight attacks against Germany proper, 42% of the German fighter strength was concentrated in Western Europe, 33% of it in Russia, and 25% in the Mediterranean area. After 10 months of American bombers appearing by day over Germany, the figures line up more like this. On the Russian front, 19%. In the Mediterranean area, 12%. And in Western Europe, 69%. Germany thought it was urgent enough to withdraw fighters from two important theaters, all in a vain attempt to save their crumbling industry from the grim, destructive blows of the British-American bomber offensive. That is why the Battle of Germany is being fought. Now we come to the problem, how are the targets selected? And what enormous effort is necessary for the 10 or 15 minutes that our air task forces will be over any given target? The daylight bombing offensive against Germany is the responsibility of the 8th Air Force. Under the 8th Air Force are the 8th Bomber Command, the 8th Fighter Command, and the 8th Air Service Command, all of whom contribute to every bombing mission. But it is the Bomber Command which is charged with the actual destruction of the selected targets. The Bomber Command, with which this picture is primarily concerned, is divided into three divisions. Each division has a number of combat wings. Each combat wing, in turn, has three groups. This is the chain of command. Since the operations which we are to follow, there have been some organizational changes, but they are principally changes of nomenclature and have not affected the broad strategical and tactical purposes of the organization. For instance, what is referred to as Bomber Command in this picture is now the 8th Air Force. Weather is the greatest single enemy of the 8th Bomber Command, for here is to be found the most changeable, treacherous weather in the world. To keep the most accurate possible check on weather conditions all over Europe, the RAF has established vast communication and reporting systems. Weather planes such as this Mosquito and our own B-17s are continually in the air in an effort to know in advance what the weather will be over Europe and the United Kingdom. Men like this supply a major portion of the data from which 8 main weather maps of Europe and of the United Kingdom are drawn each day. In addition, there are 4 upper air maps and 8 maps of a miscellaneous classification. In this room, all weather information is collected, coordinated by the RAF, and sent out by teletype to every responsible command. This is the weather section in the operations block at the Bomber Command. Here, the information gleaned from the weather stations is put together and correlated into weather maps. Accurate predictions must be made as to the direction and speed of the wind, downward and forward visibility, temperature, humidity, possible icing conditions, and probable atmospheric pressure at the bases, en route, and over the target. Upon the findings made in this room will depend whether or not there will be an American bombing of a German target tomorrow. This is the operations room of the Bomber Command. Here is where the wheels are put in motion for any American bombing attack. Right now, the officers you see are waiting for the commanding general's morning conference. They are the A3, or operations officer, the operational intelligence officer, a weather officer, and other members of the staff.
What's the weather prospects today, Major?
It looks like most of Germany will be pretty good, sir. But we have a warm front approaching from down here, which we do not expect to affect the bases until late in the evening.
How's the weather at Anklam?
At Anklam, sir, we expect 2 to 5 tenths of low cloud and small amounts of middle and high cloud above 18,000 feet. Visibility 6 to 8 miles.
How about Marienburg?
At Marienburg, 2 to 4 tenths of low cloud, little or no middle or high cloud, visibility 6 to 8 miles.
What will it be at Danzig and Gdynia?
At Danzig and Gdynia, sir, 2 to 5 tenths of low cloud, 2 to 4 tenths of high cloud above 23,000 feet. Visibility in there about 5 miles, sir.
Give me the map of Anklam and the picture of the aircraft factory there.
Yes, sir.
All right, Marienburg, the Fort Wolf factory.
Yes, sir.
We will attack Marienburg with two combat wings, Anklam with two combat wings, the shipyards of Danzig with two combat wings, and the port facilities at Gdynia with two combat wings. That will require a maximum effort.
Now the various specialist officers then go into action. This is the operational intelligence section. Here are target files containing complete information as to the type, construction, and vulnerability of the targets. This data is gathered both from photo interpretation of aerial pictures and from confidential ground sources. On the basis of this information, the aiming point for the attack will be selected. The aiming point is a building or installation in the approximate center of the target. Here, operational research experts are minutely studying the architectural and construction details of the targets. It will be their duty to recommend, on the basis of studies previously made, the types of bombs and the proper fusing to accomplish the greatest possible destruction of the objective. These studies of the Arado factory at Anklam are immensely important, since the nose and tail fuses of a bomb can be adjusted to give varying degrees of delay between the time of initial impact and the explosion. For example, an improperly fused bomb would react something like this. Result, very superficial damage that may hardly even cause delay in production. On the other hand, here's what happens when a properly fused bomb strikes the same factory. Two bombs of exactly identical weight and explosive power have totally different effects because one was fused properly and the other was not. It is the responsibility of the operational research section to determine proper bomb fusing. Here, the commanding general and the operations officer are working out the overall planning of each of the missions with the staff bombardier, the staff navigator, and the flak officer. This is a complex business, because of the multiple nature of the attack.
We'll attack Anklam 1 hour before we attack the other targets. That should draw most of the German fighters on the Anklam force. The Anklam force is big enough to take care of itself.
You mean along the same course, sir?
No, send them a little south. They'll act as a better diversion.
This would be the best place across the coast from the standpoint of pilotage.
But, sir, the flak concentration at that point is quite heavy, the heaviest along the coast. We could rather move them a little further south, what the general suggests, and they would not run into flak difficulties at that point.
How is that for the navigation viewpoint?
That's a very good landfall, sir.
All right, we'll cross at that point, and you adjust the flight times accordingly.
Take care of it, Darrell.
Yes, sir.
While this is going on, the various liaison officers stationed at Bomber Command headquarters are busy keeping their respective commands acquainted with the course of events. The closest liaison is maintained with both the RAF Fighter and Bomber Commands, the Royal Navy, the 8th Fighter Command, and the 9th Bomber Command. It is through these liaison officers that requests will be made for the necessary fighter support, diversionary effort by the medium bombers, air sea rescue patrols, and so on. Officers at Fighter Command immediately look up plan number 2340 to find out what part the fighters are expected to play in the next day's operations. Similarly, the 9th Air Force is informed that Bomber Command intends to lay on plan number 2340. It will be the duty of the mediums to attack enemy airfields at a time that will cause maximum interference with German attempts to intercept the heavy bombers. Right now, weather officers are getting ready their forecast for the general's late afternoon conference, where final decisions will be made.
Right in there as planned. Yeah, it should. Should be okay. Thanks. Good night.
Goodbye.
Does your morning's forecast still hold?
Yes, sir. There's practically no change in the situation, and we still expect the base weather to hold up for return.
Send out the field order exactly as planned.
Yes, sir. Get me the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd divisions on a conference call, please.
Already with your conference call. Go ahead, please.
Can you scramble? Okay. Over.
Okay, over.
Over. Okay, there's a mission tomorrow. Maximum effort with 5 task forces. The 1st task force, comprising 6 groups of the 1st division, will hit 3948.
3948.
Secondary, 8731.
8731.
Last resort, 9009.
9009.
The 2nd task force, comprising 5 groups of the 3rd division, will hit 6848.
6848.
Secondary, 6424.
6424.
Last resort, 5381.
5381.
The 3rd task force will comprise 4 groups of the 2nd division, which will hit 6424.
6424.
Secondary, 5381.
5381.
Last resort, any industrial target of importance in Germany.
Okay.
The 1st and 3rd divisions will each dispatch 1 air.
The field order now goes over the teletype to all interested units and command. The first step has been taken in the sequence of events that will finally result in bringing our planes over the targets and discharging their bomb loads. Command has conceived the mission and laid out general plans and routes. Division now plans in detail what command has ordered. The actual time of assembly of the various task forces is determined. The combat wings are assigned to their specific task forces, and the routes from assembly to rendezvous points and the target are charted. Many considerations go into the selection of the routes. Here is the commanding general of the 1st Division, which you will remember has 2 targets for tomorrow, Anklam and Gdynia.
Control point here at 0 hour. Another control point here for the northern unit, 0+40 minutes. The other friendly...
From that timing, where will that put our northern force at the time that our southern force hits the IP?
The northern force should be about the east coast of Denmark at that time, sir.
Well, it looks like we're going to catch all the fighters on the southern force, aren't we?
Looks very much that way, sir.
I think we'd better bend that route around so it's headed towards Berlin. If we can pin those German fighters down at Berlin until we can get started home, they'll never catch us.
At the 2nd Division, the target for tomorrow is Danzig.
Danzig, eh? That's fine. How many ships do we have for tomorrow?
Well, sir, if you recall, General, on our last mission, we had heavy battle damage, and not all those aircraft are repaired yet.
Call up the wing commanders and have them put pressure on the groups. Get their maintenance crews to work on these ships tonight and get every possible airplane on the line in the morning.
The 3rd Division, which will have for its targets Marienburg and Gdynia.
Looks pretty good, sir. We're going to be right over a lake there for a good checkpoint at the turn. We're going in against the sun. The sun will be at our back, sir.
Defenses at the target. Major Frost, what about the flak defenses?
Sir, at the upper target, there are 24 guns. That approach is good. Lower target isn't defended by heavy guns.
No heavy guns whatever at Marienburg.
None, sir.
The division's operations officer bases his precise plans on aircraft and crews available at the various groups. He then calls the combat wings to give them advance information before the field order actually arrives.
Operator, give me combat wings for conference, please. Okay. Scramble. Over.
Okay.
Over.
Over.
For tomorrow, 1st Bomb Division will be called on for 2 task forces. 1st task force will be made up of 2 combat wings on
8.
8-7-3-1.
8-7-3-1. Last resort 9009. 9009. Lead group is task force.
Okay, ready to scramble? Over.
Okay. Over.
There'll be a mission tomorrow. And I want two groups from each combat wing. The target will be primary 6-4-2-4.
6-4-2-4.
Secondary 5-3-8-1.
5-3-8-1.
The last resort will be any industrial target of importance in Germany.
Okay.
There's an order coming through. The 3rd Division will furnish 8 groups. 1st and 2nd wings, comprising the 2nd Task Force, will hit 6-8-4-8.
6-8-4-8.
Secondary 6-4-2-4.
6-4-2-4.
Last resort 5-3-8-1.
5-3-8-1.
Last resort. Bomb load. 500-pound GPs, fused, 1/10 nose, 1/100 tail.
1/10 nose, 1/100 tail.
This is operations of the combat wing, a purely tactical unit having absolutely no administrative functions whatsoever.
How do you intend to make it?
Sir, we'll assemble over Molesworth.
Problems of takeoff and assembly are the particular specialized function of this organization. It is the primary business of the combat wing to get the airplanes of its group into the air at the proper times and to get them assembled once in the air.
Field order requires that we provide the 2nd Combat Wing and the 2nd Air Task Force. 89th Group will lead, 81st Group will be high, and the 63rd Group will be low.
That means that Colonel Whitten will lead the Combat Wing on this mission?
That'll be fine.
The Bomber Command has asked for a maximum effort. Yes. That means every available plane is to be gotten into the air.
Ramsey, this field order has called for 3,100 gallons for the H's due to the distance. Now, they've called for maximum bomb load. How about that for the weight?
I think we'd better put 8 bombs in the H's and 12 in the D's. That keeps us around 65,000 pounds.
How about the CG?
CG is well forward, and I think it'll work out very well because we're down low for a long period of time.
All right, we'll have 8 in the H's and maximum in the D's.
Most of the groups are going further than an American bomber has gone before. Combat wings must work out precisely the maximum bomb load in relation to the required gas load. Decisions made in this and other matters are added to the division's field order and passed on to the groups, the ultimate tactical unit, to the men who get the planes in the air and fly the mission. On the basis of the alert telephoned down to the group by the combat wing, the various agencies necessary to get the planes airborne on their mission wheel into action. Intelligence, operations, weather, signals, group navigators and bombardiers have the grave responsibility of passing on and making clear to the combat crews the vital target and route information furnished by Bomber Command and Bomb Division. The proper information folders, maps, weather maps and charts, and photographs have to be selected by the various group officers and then the information therein passed on to the crews. In dispersal areas, ground crews are getting their planes in condition to fly the mission. The normal work of keeping an airplane fit for operation is enormous, even in peacetime. When you add to this already great job the element of battle damage, the problem becomes gigantic. Engines, wings, propellers, controls, wiring, fuel system, oxygen system, the 1,001 elements that go to make up the complex mechanics of a heavy bombardment plane, all must be kept in perfect shape. The failure of any one of them on a mission can easily mean the loss of the plane and its personnel, or at best, such a failure will cause the plane to abort, that is, return to its base without having reached the target. It was originally estimated that about 37.5% of planes on hand would be effective at one time. However, the maintenance and repair has been so magnificently performed that sometimes up to 50% of planes on hand have been effective. Ordnance is already at work, getting the bombs in their racks and loading ammunition onto the plane. These are 100-pound incendiaries. These are 500-pound general-purpose bombs. And these are 1,000-pound GPs. Bombs have to be placed in their racks very carefully. One bomb sticking in its rack through careless placement might make a whole mission useless so far as that individual plane goes. O'clock in the morning. All over England at this exact moment, American air crews are being roused from their sleep.
Okay, fellas, roll out. We have a mission this morning. Breakfast in half an hour. Captain Kirk, Captain Thompson, Lieutenant Buska, Ackerson, Holloway, and Hawker scheduled to fly. We'll snap it up.
3 o'clock. This is a hell of a time to get a man out of bed.
Oh, come on, you drips. Out of bed. Breakfast in half an hour. Come on, Nick. Rise and shine.
All right, you dodos. Let's go. This is it. Okay, fellas. Let's go. Come on, Swifty. Get it out. Let's go.
Go, you guys. Hit the deck. Breakfast at 4. Breathing at 5. Let's go.
That's fine. Just when I had a 48-hour pass coming up.
That'd be a good deal.
Can't you guys? You're ruining my beauty sleep.
Through the cold of the English early morning, the combat crews go to their mess. They have no idea where they're going yet, but they know they'll be taking off in about 4 hours.
Jerry's will be today.
What do you think, Dove? They'll be shooting at us.
Sometimes I don't think little Jerry's got proper respect for us.
Well, what do you expect, Buster, the way you shoot?
Jerry, look who's talking. You couldn't hit a cow in the flank with a bow feather.
Yeah, well, how about those two Jerrys I slapped down over Swineford?
I'll tell you what happened there. They heard that I was on a tail guns and they fainted from fright, that's all.
And so it goes. The 4,000 men who will go on this mission all know it will be a rugged deal. For some of them, it's their first mission. Others are veterans of many.
Happy to get through.
Now, at all the groups in the bomber command, the air crews are assembling in the briefing rooms to learn the target for today.
Okay, boys, let's go.
Thank you.
This is the briefing room of the 303rd Group. Here in a few minutes, the nature, locale, and route of today's mission will be made known to the men who fly it.
Target for today is Ankrum. Specifically, you are to destroy the Arado factory. This plant manufactures aircraft components, principally wing and tail assemblies for the Focke-Wulf 190. The parts are then shipped to New Brandenburg for assembly. I cannot stress upon you too much the importance of this target. If it is successfully destroyed, it will have a very serious effect on Germany's aircraft production. Lights, please. Your IP is on the northwest side of New Brandenburg. Your heading on your run-up will be 45 degrees true. Immediately after your turn, you have an aerodrome on your right, almost directly north of the town. You should be able to pick out Friedland, 6 miles to your right and halfway between your IP and the target. Along this route, you should be able to see the main line railroad and the main road. From Friedland, the main road moves in toward your run-up and goes into Ankrum, but the railroad terminates at Friedland. Shortly after passing Friedland, you will see a peculiarly formed wooded area
on the right of your course.
From here, pick out the aerodrome slightly southwest of the city and the intersection of the main railroad and the Peen River just outside of the town to the north.
Night target map.
Your target is across the railroad, beyond the town, in the area formed by the bend of the river.
And now a picture of the target.
This group of buildings here is your target. This building will be the aiming point. If your bomb pattern is concentrated in this area, it should very effectively knock out the factory. Lights, please.
At the 379th, the intelligent briefing continues.
Late group will bomb from an altitude of 13,000 feet. We feel that this low altitude will be equalized by the element of surprise which is with us, and should ensure a thorough and complete finding of the target.
Another task force is hitting the FW-190 assembly plant at Marienburg. If the two missions are successful, 65% of Jerry's remaining FW-190 production and assembly facilities will be destroyed.
At the 384th.
Other forces are attacking submarine yards, aircraft assembly plants, and units of the German fleet at Danzig and Gdynia. If these attacks succeed, they will destroy 13.5% of Germany's remaining U-boat construction and will destroy or immobilize a large section of the German Navy. The overall result of all four attacks will be to show the Hun that his efforts to protect his key industries by moving them to the east will be unsuccessful. It'll show him that we will seek out his industry and destroy it wherever he places it.
At the 351st, the intelligence briefing is completed.
Your secondary target this morning is the air park at Tutoff. This contains a Focke-Wulf assembly plant, a bombardier school, and you'll love this. It's the country club of the German Air Force. Should you be unable to bomb either of those two targets, then in that case, you'll attempt to bomb the last resort target, which is the Hankel assembly plant at Rostock. This is the only complete Hankel unit in North Germany. It should be easily identified by the airfield adjoining, which has six intersecting runways running from 1,000 to 1,600 yards, and they're full of nice, fat, juicy Hankels.
A weather officer briefs the crews of the 305th group going to Gdynia.
The synoptic situation today is this. We have a high pressure system centered over northwest Europe, up here near Finland, extending southwestward down across the British Isles, causing an influx of south and southwesterly air going up in this direction. fuzzy, little, or no cloud in the area up there and toward your target. There are no fronts to affect your route today except a frontal system off to the west, which will cause an increase of medium and high clouds as you come back across the North Sea. Lights, please. At takeoff time, there will be 0 to 3/10 low clouds, also a layer of high clouds above 23,000 feet, 4 to 6/10 in amount, also a middle layer of clouds in there between 10 and 12,000 feet, these medium and high clouds decreasing out over the North Sea to 3 to 5/10 each in amount. The low clouds will increase as you go out toward the North Sea to 3 to 5/10. Base, 1,500 to 2,000 feet, tops 4 to 5,000 feet. There will be some fog patches over England, visibility 1 to 2 miles, except in those fog patches 500 to 1,000 yards. Visibility increasing rapidly out over the North Sea and the remainder of your route to 4 to 6 miles. The high clouds continuing 3 to 5/10, and also the middle clouds on toward the target, decreasing to nil at the target. Low clouds continuing 3 to 5/10, decreasing to 2 to 4/10 at the target. Base 2,000 feet, tops 5,000 feet. Visibility 4 to 6 miles. The temperature at bombing altitude minus 26 degrees centigrade. The freezing level on your route out, 12,000 feet over the North Sea with light rime in the middle clouds. As you return back to base, that freezing level will lower to about 7,000 feet, continuing light rime in your middle clouds. Now on the return route, weather will be very similar to your route out, except your clouds increasing in amount as you proceed back across the North Sea. Base on return, visibility 4 to 6 miles.
A flak officer briefs the 389th group of the 2nd Division going to Danzig.
Now, gentlemen, this morning, because we are going to cross the Danish coast at such a relatively low altitude, we've planned the route so as to avoid as much flak as possible. At any rate, any flak that you do encounter will be merely a deterrent in nature. However, you can expect heavy flak batteries at a place where we make landfall here at Namindagab, Gap, about a mile south of course. Also, there are known to be other heavy batteries 8 miles south of course there on the coast at Hem. Other batteries are known to be located here at Korsor, 20 miles south of course, on the island of Skellum. From then on aim the target, you will have very little flak. Now, while you're crossing the coast and when you're over aerodromes and cities in Denmark, you are advised to take evasive action. Now then, when you get to the target itself, your anti-aircraft fire from the ground will be known to be supported by fire from naval units. Now, for those of you who have never been fired on by a naval unit, I want to add that naval units can put up a hell of an intense barrage, and you want to look out for it.
An operations officer briefs the crews of the 94th Group of the 3rd Division.
This group is leading a formation to Mariensburg today.
The 880th will be high group and the 764th will be low group.
Bomb load of each ship will be 3 1,000 pounders, used 1/10 nose and 1/100 tail. Get that, bombardiers. You'll also carry 5 M47A incendiaries.
You'll have full Tokyo's, 1,000 gallons extra. Takeoff will be normal, assembly 1,000 feet over the field.
After takeoff and assembly, proceed up this line to this point. This will be your combat wing assembly line. You'll leave the coast at this point here, that's splasher 15. Let's not have any stooging around over England, it's a long haul. The 57th combat wing will follow us today at a 3 mile interval.
Now to the 95th group.
B-26s will be hitting the Lille area and the lowland at approximately 0 hour minus 40 minutes. One group of P-47s will strike the Warden area and join us for escort on the way out, joining us at approximately this point here. All other forces are using approximately the same route today. Just one point, and that's that the Anklam force will probably pass us coming out as we're on our way in. You should see plenty of air activity. Let's hope that most of it is ours. The climb will commence at the English coast, climbing at 150 miles an hour, 100 feet per minute. We should reach bombing altitude approximately the Danish coast, and under no circumstances should the Danish coast be crossed at less than 12,000 feet. We will drain Tokyo's as soon as possible. We should have plenty of gas. We figure approximately 400 gallons overload.
At the 100th, the operations briefing is completed.
Fly loose formation today with groups echelon to the right until a point 75 miles from the enemy coast, where normal combat wing formation will be assumed. For visibility, everybody use Aldous lamp. The Royal Navy will be out patrolling the sea routes, so any crews that have to ditch will probably be rescued very quickly. The commanding general of Bomber Command asked us to put out a special effort today, so let's give it to him.
The commanding officer of the group invariably has a few words to say.
Men, the going's going to be rough. You're going to have to bow your neck in there and stay in there and pitch every minute.
Now, gentlemen, this is the type of target you don't want to have to go back after the second time. If you fly a good, tight formation, get a good, dense pattern on that target, we won't have to.
This Anklam crowd down here may pull most of the fighters off of us. However, that's just a guess. So particularly for you gunners, you've got to be on the ball from the Danish coast onto the target.
Flak will be heavy, probably accurate. Been through worse before. Remember that your biggest enemy is still the single-engine fighter plane.
Now, you bombardiers, take your time in going in on your releases. But don't allow the flak to worry you. It's merely to break up your formation.
Now, if you get in any trouble up in this area, remember you can always board Sweden. Get on, it's a neutral country. And it's close over there.
Could be rough. I don't think it'll be too bad. And whether it's easy or rough, I'll be sitting out in front, taking the whole works in.
The main briefing over, the pilots, navigators, bombardiers, radio operators, gunners, receive separate specialized briefings. These briefings are very technical and very thorough, and are held so that every member of the combat crew will understand exactly what he can expect and what is expected of him. Any lack of thoroughness here might very well result in the failure of a mission. As dawn breaks over the English countryside, it finds the ground crews still working grimly in an effort to get every plane in the air that is scheduled to be dispatched. Take as fierce a pride in their planes as do the air crews. To each of them, it is a personal tragedy, reflecting in some way on their capabilities when their airplane is forced to turn back without having completed its mission, or when they have been unable to get an expected plane ready in time for a mission. It's getting on to the time when the combat crews go to their planes. Here they are in the crew room, putting on their flying clothes. Clothes and equipment especially constructed to ward off the intense sub-zero cold which they will encounter so shortly. All air crew members receive escape kits containing equipment that will help them get back to safety if they are forced down in Germany or in occupied territory. The pilots, co-pilots, navigators and bombardiers are also issued battle folders containing the maps which will be of such vital importance to them in the prosecution of the mission. the men turn in all personal papers and valuables, which might serve to give the enemy information in case of capture. Some of the crew members turn to their chaplain, whose ministrations are always available to the men of the bomber bases. So changeable is the weather in the European theater that sometimes widely varying conditions will be found on fields only a few miles from each other. Now the last briefing of all, the final intimate conference around each airplane as the pilots recheck the details of the mission with their crews. Crew members have ceased to exist as individuals. They are now 10-man teams, and on the excellence of their teamwork will depend the success of the operation. Of 20-odd fields of the 8th Air Force, more than 400 forts and liberators, with their 4,000 crew members, taxi for the takeoff. lead plane of each squadron, upon becoming airborne, proceeds for about 90 seconds. It banks sharply to indicate its turning point, then goes into a slow left turn. Each successive plane in the element turns as soon as the pilot sees the plane in front of him turn. The element of three planes levels off at 1,000 feet and returns parallel to the takeoff runway at a distance of about 2 miles. Here the elements start to assemble into squadrons of six. Continuing to circle the field, the squadrons then go to 2,000 feet, where the group assembly takes place. This accomplished, the group now moves on to the combat wing assembly point. Here is how the group stacks up from the side. The group has a depth of 850 feet. This is how the group looks from above. In the lead squadron, the second element is flown with the nose of the leader slightly behind and to the right of the right wing aircraft, first element. The lead plane of the high squadron flies even with the lead plane, second element, lead squadron. The second element of the high squadron flies with the leader's nose just behind and to the left of the left wing aircraft, first element. Here is the group as an enemy fighter pilot sees it from head on. The first element of the lead squadron is stacked high left and low right. The first element of the low squadron is stacked high right and low left. Likewise, the first element of the high squadron is stacked high right and low left. All second elements are flown low. The second element of the lead squadron is stacked high left and low right. The second elements of the high and low squadrons are stacked high right and low left. Experience has shown that this arrangement of the group brings to bear on attacking fighters the greatest possible amount of firepower by utilizing to fullest advantage the field of fire of each gun in the formation. Again, it has proved to be the most maneuverable formation from which to execute the primary and all-important purpose of the mission, the dropping of the bomb loads on a precise target. Obviously, it would be desirable to stack as many bombing planes as possible in one defensive formation. However, it has been found that the largest practical defensive formation is the combat wing of three groups. Any formation of aircraft larger than this becomes unwieldy. This force has a depth of 3,000 feet. The nose of the lead aircraft of the low group is aligned with the tail and slightly to the left of the rearmost aircraft of the lead element, lead squadron, lead group. The nose of the lead aircraft of the high group is aligned with the tail of the rearmost aircraft of the lead element, lead squadron, lead group. The combat wing having been assembled, they now move on to make rendezvous with the rest of the task force. In this case, another combat wing. This plane from the force, which is to attack Anklam, is now approaching the Danish coast, and the formation is subject to enemy attack at any moment. It is now 10:30 hours, and Denmark has been penetrated to some distance without any great opposition as yet. So far, there has been only some light and inaccurate flak at the coastline.
Some flak guns have opened up on us. On, the Anklam formation has to contend with constant German fighter attack from all levels and all clock positions. During this time, the gunners aboard the fortresses knock down fighter after fighter. However, the gunnery of the forts, no matter how sensational it may be, is only to ensure the successful performance of the mission. It is not the job or purpose of forts or liberators to seek out action with enemy fighters. They merely defend themselves against enemy fighter attack so that they can destroy their target and bring their crews back safely to their home bases. An anxious moment comes now for the lead navigator and bombardier. The formation is approaching the initial point. That is the point where the wing will turn off and make its bombing run on the target. Upon proper navigation to this point may rest the success of the entire mission.
Pilot to left waist gunner. We're over the IP. Release flares. Waist gunner to pilot. Roger.
Once the combat wing has reached the IP, it breaks up into three component groups, for the wing formation is too unwieldy for a unit bombing operation. As the IP is reached and the lead airplane of the lead group is about to make the turn, it fires two red flares, spaced 5 seconds apart. Then the group makes its turn onto the run-up. The low group goes on straight ahead for 20 seconds, then makes its turn. The high group proceeds for 20 seconds beyond the low group's turn, then it turns on to the run-up. The most critical defensive period in the mission has begun. The wing, to accomplish most efficiently its primary purpose, the bombing of the target, has sacrificed its mutual defensive firepower, and the groups are thrown on their own. Now the crucial moment is almost here. The moment around which the entire mission revolves.
Pilot to Bombardier, your ship.
Bombardier to pilot, roger.
Bombardier to crew, bombay doors open.
Bomb bay doors open, the group is committed to its attack. No evasive action may be taken until the bombs are away. And at this time, the formation is most vulnerable to attack, both from flak and enemy fighters. Marienburg, an hour later, the second task force comes over the target.
Bombs away!
Task force comes over its target at Danzig.
Bombs away!
The fourth and fifth task forces arrive over the harbor area of Gdynia.
Bombs away!
Bombs away! It is standard procedure for the group leader to inform Bomber Command the moment the target has been attacked. Bomber Command, in turn, promptly informs the commanding general of the 8th Air Force.
Yes. Yes, sir. I'll advise you as soon as they land.
After getting bombs away and closing the bomb bay doors, the groups can now defend themselves again, at least to the extent of evasive action against the flak and fighter attack. Lead group flies a straight course for 15 seconds before turning off to the rally point. The lead group then proceeds to the rally point at an indicated airspeed of 155 miles per hour, making S-turns meanwhile to permit the trailing groups to catch up. The lead group crosses the rally point at a height 1,000 feet lower than bombing altitude. The succeeding groups will close with the lead group as quickly as possible to regain the defensive combat wing formation. The following groups need not necessarily pass exactly over the rally point in regaining wing formation. In the meanwhile, the Marauders take off to fulfill their part in the day's operation. They bomb the airdrome at Wonsdrecht, one of the most important of the enemy's fighter bases. This blow by the medium bombers is timed so as to provide the maximum interference with the enemy's capacity to intercept our withdrawing heavy bombers. Last off are the fighters. Their great speed will enable them to reach the Leeuwarden district in a short time, sweep the area clear of enemy fighters, then give the heavy bombers withdrawal support from the enemy coast home. At the fields, it's getting on towards the most nervous of all times, the estimated time of return. Everyone who stays behind sweats out this period at the end of each mission. Here at the control tower, at the dispersal areas, at the Red Cross, at the officers' club, everywhere on the field, the one thing paramount in everyone's mind is that the group is due back. To attack the target. How many have returned? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 15, 16, 17, 18. 18 dispatched, 18 returned. 23 dispatched. 23 return. However, there are other groups which weren't so fortunate. 18 dispatched, 17 return. 20 dispatched, 19 return. 20 dispatched, 14 return. 19 dispatched, 18 return. 20 dispatched, 10 return. 18 dispatched, 8 return. Flares dropped from aircraft signal the presence of wounded aboard. These airplanes are given priority in landing. Airmen are home, but their job isn't over yet. Before they can go to their billets for a well-earned rest, they must first undergo one of the most important phases of any mission, interrogation. It is highly important to question the crews at the first possible moment after the mission, while their impressions and memories are still fresh. Crews who have anything of immediate importance to report go at once to the hot newsroom.
Hello, boys. How are you?
Well, kind of long, not too rough.
Best bombing job we've ever done.
Good, good. Somebody in trouble?
Yeah, we saw a 1B-17 go down there just before we made landfall.
Where was that?
Well, that was at 5240 north.
5240, yes.
1 degree, 50 minutes east.
0150 east. Yes, and what time was that?
That was at 1524.
And was that a G-fix?
That was a G-fix, yes. And we had the radio operator get on the MFDF section. He sent in the coordinates of the fix.
Good.
And I had my radio operator turn his IFF to emergency when we saw it go down.
Okay. And what happened?
Well, the ship went down, apparently under control, and saw it hit the water.
Yes, I was looking through the glasses, and I saw two dinghies come out, and 10 men, apparently all okay, Major.
Good. And what altitude were you?
We were at 5,000 feet at the time.
Okay, anything else?
No, no. Settle up for a cup of coffee. It's waiting for you, boy.
Okay. Thank you.
Third division, please.
There you are, Smitty. I got a B-17 crew down the dinghy.
Thanks, Bill. 16 group, please. Special aircraft priority. Flight control, please. 16, bomb division here. We have a B-17 reported fixed at 52 degrees 30 minutes north, 1 degree 30 minutes east. That's right. He was seen to ditch. Yes. He was seen to ditch at 1524 hours by the reporting aircraft. Two dinghies were seen to break out, and 10 men got into them. The reporting aircraft is at 5,000 feet. Yes, that position's an MF fix. Okay, 16. Thank you.
One way or another, scores of our crews are saved by air sea rescue from the English Channel and the North Sea and returned to combat service. Aside from human values, a trained fortress crew is even more valuable than the plane they man. And the work of the air sea rescue unit has been of enormous value to the 8th Air Force. The hungry crews are fed enough to hold them until they can be interrogated and get to their regular chow. These men are from the groups that went to Anklam.
What time did you go over the target?
At 11:43 hours. We went in at 12,000 feet.
Did you get your bombs on the target?
Yeah.
What about enemy fighter opposition?
Well, that's something we'd sooner not discuss.
Really, really.
Well, let's get some of the details. Where did it begin, Paul?
Well, they first jumped us at 10:30 there, just off the Danish coast.
And how long did the attack continue?
They stayed with us to the target and until 13:27. Then at 13:45, we had another group attack and stayed until 14:05. We had a couple more attacks, and the last one was at 15:26, just off the Danish coast coming out.
And about how many enemy fighters did you see?
Well, I don't know how many of them might have been reputed, but I saw 60 or 70 myself.
I couldn't keep track of them, sir, but I counted about 65.
Well, I stopped trying to count when I got to 50, sir.
Well, do you think it'd be accurate to say then that your ship saw between 65 and 80 enemy aircraft?
Yes. Yes.
What type of enemy aircraft did you encounter?
Well, from what I could see from the tail, they threw the book at us. FW-190s, ME-109s, 110s, 210s, Dornians, even JU-87s and 88s.
I saw a couple of Focke-Wulf 189s, at least two Heinkel 111s.
What positions did they attack from?
Oh, they came from all over the place.
Fighters are pressing home their attacks from 300 to 400 yards.
Would you characterize these attacks as determined?
Determined?
Oh, brother, you can say that again.
No, I think those guys are really trying to shoot us down.
I wouldn't be surprised.
How would you describe the enemy fighter tactics?
Well, I'd describe them as murderous.
Yes, they usually attacked in formation to queue up about 300 or 400 yards away, 12 to 13 single-engine fighters come barreling right through the formation.
How'd the twin-engine fighters react?
They stayed out to the side and above, just out of range of our guns and shouted cannons and rockets at us. Then they'd queue up and press home a regular fighter attack.
What caliber would you say the cannons were?
My guess would be 37 millimeters. What do you think, Adam?
What about the rockets?
They shot a lot of them. I didn't actually see any hit our formation, but they weren't doing us any good.
I saw one of them blow a wing off the 17 below and ahead of us. They started to spin in. No, sir, I didn't say anything.
Where was this?
Over the target, right after we talked about bombs.
Did you notice any distinctive markings on the enemy aircraft?
Yeah, I saw quite
a few.
There are a number of FW-190s, mostly yellow noses, some white noses.
No red nose?
No, I didn't see any.
Boy, those yellow nose boys really come in close, don't they? Did you see that one come right on our left wing?
Yeah, I saw a 109 with black and white diagonal markings under the wings.
Black and white, huh?
It had white nose.
All right. Yeah.
Getting back to those rockets, I believe that Jerry can reload his rocket guns from inside the ship.
I think
you
can.
That'd be my guess, too.
I saw at least 9 bursts from rocket guns on one ME-210.
9 bursts, huh?
Talking about 210s, there was one that came in and shot a cluster. It looked like clay pigeons to me.
Say, those things looked like baseballs to me. Can you describe that more fully? How did they react?
Well, they didn't look like baseballs. It was more like streamlined and smoked all the way down, but they didn't explode.
Didn't explode, huh?
No.
What about planes?
I knocked down two. They were making attacks about 5 o'clock level.
Yeah, I saw them. One of them blew up in the air, and the other one went down in flames. The pilot of the second one bailed out. That was at 11:44. We were right over the IP.
Were any other guns firing at these planes? No, sir. These were my babies.
Any more?
Yes, sir. I got one destroyed and one probable. I knocked a 210 down right over the target. The plane exploded in the air. I got a burst of a 110, and it started down in flames. I couldn't see whether it went all the way down. Not we were under constant attack.
Bombing results and enemy fighter reaction are only one phase of the interrogation. The enemy's anti-aircraft defenses, their concentration, and their accuracy are also matters of great interest to the interrogators. The group of the 2nd Division, which went to Danzig.
How would you describe the flak and route of the target?
From the coast of the target, it was meager and inaccurate as to height and deflection. Over the target, it was still meager, but pretty accurate as to height and deflection.
Is that how the rest of you fellows would describe it?
What about on the way back?
Well, it was meager and inaccurate, except now when we crossed the coast. They threw up a box barrage that was pretty accurate as to height. In fact, it was good at the altitude, but the deflection was a little off. The first burst hit about 100 yards ahead of the lead plane, and we felt the concussion of it, right?
We got a couple of flak holes and fuselage right around my gun position.
Any other battle damage?
A couple of flak holes in the nose. Burst of 303 in the number 4 engine. Got an oil line.
What was your altitude when this box barrage almost caught you?
21,500 feet.
Did any of you notice anything unusual or peculiar about the flak burst?
No, it looked like the same old black flak to me.
Was the 6th we have seen it?
Also valuable to the interrogator is any intelligence that might be picked up by the crews en route to or from the target. Such observations may be completely incidental to the mission, but can prove to be of great value at another time when another target is being attacked. Let's find out what the force attacking Marienburg discovered on their way to and from the target.
This smoke screen at Danzig, where did that emanate from?
Well, it looked like to me it was coming from off of floats and boats here with smudge spots on them, anchored just a little ways off the coast.
Yeah, Ernie, they were shooting it up from the ground, too, and it get up so high and burst and mushroom out. Would you say it was effective?
Well, we didn't pass right over the city itself, so we couldn't say definitely, but it looked like to me it'd be pretty doggone effective.
Was it all great?
Yeah.
You see anything else?
Yeah, there's a new airport about 2 miles below Danzig there, south of Danzig.
What it look like?
Pretty large airport with grass runways and a lot of construction at the south end.
I seen another one there at Popkin. Seemed like it's building runways and some buildings, new buildings like that, quite enough to be hangars.
Okay. Now, how about military installations? Did you see any of those?
Well, south of Stadtorf in East Prussia, we saw some installations that might have been fortifications.
They were large, rectangular buildings with red tops.
Yeah, there were 2 rows of 4.
4 buildings each?
Yes.
Good deal. Now, did you see anything else?
As soon as interrogation of the men is finished, the interrogation forms are checked, and general statistics on the group's part in the attack are compiled.
All right, let's get going on this report.
Okay. B, number of aircraft dispatched.
20, which?
C, number of aircraft attacking the primary target.
20. Hello, I want the A2 duty desk. Hello, this is Norgren 492. Got a flash teletype report for you. You ready?
The organizational flow, which we have observed throughout this picture, has now begun to operate in reverse. Information obtained from the crews is evaluated in divisional critiques, conferences in which all responsible group and divisional officers carefully inspect the detailed record of the mission, discuss any failures that may have occurred, and plan to prevent their recurrence. After a particularly large or important operation, there will be a command critique, with the 8th Air Force Commanding General presiding. Here in the dark room, the strike photos of the targets brought back by the returning planes of the group are developed and printed with all possible speed, so that experts of Bomber Command can assess the damage done. Coming in from planes of every group participating in the various raids and interpreted and appraised by trained photo interpreters, these pictures will give Bomber Command an excellent idea as to exactly what parts of the various targets were hit and how severely. Here, as seen in these pictures, taken the following day by photo reconnaissance planes, severe damage has been inflicted on all the major and most of the minor buildings of the Arado factory at Anklam. This is a strike photo showing how Danzig looked during the attack. Very extensive damage has been suffered in the harbor area. Here is an annotated PRU picture of Gdynia as it appeared after the attack. A near miss is seen on the liner Deutschland type. The transatlantic liner Stuttgart does not appear in this picture, although she was seen afire and in the hands of tugboats immediately after the attack, as these strike photos reveal. Aside from the Stuttgart, several ships in the South Basin have been sunk or damaged, including the liner Oceania. Shore instruments are also heavily hit. At Marienburg, the PRU photo discloses that the damage was exceptionally severe, almost every building having been destroyed or seriously affected. General Arnold has characterized this attack as the greatest example of precision bombing on record. Other targets will be as thoroughly destroyed. Are pressing the Battle of Europe, the Battle of Germany continues. Day by day, whenever weather permits, heavy bombers roar out over the heads of the advancing ground forces, blasting away systematically at vital industrial installations hundreds of miles to the rear of the enemy lines. Now, in contrast to earlier days of strategic bombing, when forts and liberators fought their way alone, fleets of long-range fighters, Mustangs, Thunderbolts, Lightnings, convoy the big bombers all the way to their targets, targets which may be anywhere in German-occupied Europe. The flood of supplies so necessary to the survival of an army or a nation, synthetic rubber, steel, food, fuel, textiles, this flood is gradually being reduced to a trickle. And finally, even this thin, inadequate stream will die away. Then the German armies in the field and the German workers on the home front will have no food for their stomachs, no clothing for their bodies, no metals for their machines, and no fuel with which to run them. Then the Battle of Germany will be won, and with it, the Battle of Europe. Thank you.